So let's dig into the discussion. Can anyone identify this place? Okay. So that what I wanted to say was already covered about it. Okay. So I did my bachelor's in IT in 2015. And then I moved to Netherlands and did my if you can see the screen, I moved near in between Hague and Rotterdam to TU Delft, where I did my master's in computer science. And then I moved to do my PhD in the south of Netherlands in the Open University, and it's like a joint program where we do PhD in Open University and also simultaneously work in projects with TU Delft and also in Frankfurt, which you can see in the other red dot, because there are three red dots on the map. So my work is now kind of fluctuating from the south of Netherlands to TU Delft and Frankfurt. And currently I'm doing third year of my PhD. So normally what I do is, from last 2-3 years, I write answers in Quora to help people like you who are interested to do like masters or MBA or PhD and do anything abroad, like study abroad. So that's the reason why I'm here. Normally I come to India once a year, and I thought why not share some of my experiences and have an open discussion with all of you, so that we can like help you guys and motivate you if you are at all interested to study abroad. So I will just highlight briefly what is my PhD, because I don't think most people might understand, because everyone is from varied backgrounds. So my PhD is like in the intersection of computer science and educational science. And what I exactly do can be summed up by these figures. So it's like, suppose imagine that you are doing a group work in a classroom or in any setting, like group project work or group brainstorming. Then we try to use sensors like camera, microphone, or smart watch, or Kinect, Microsoft Kinect. And using these sensors, we try to detect the indicators of collaboration quality when people are collaborating in groups in a face-to-face setting. And then we try to give real-time feedback to facilitate this collaboration. So this is broadly what I'm doing in my PhD. I hope you get something out of it. So this is what resulted after I was writing answers in Quora. So normally when I was writing answers in Quora, I used to see that people used to contact me frequently to like help them in writing the motivation letter or the SOP, or maybe give them some brief information about studying in Netherlands or the salary or some places in Europe and blah blah blah. So when I found that I was repeating all these things again and again, that's when I made videos in the form of the YouTube channel SambitPhD, and there I share all the experiences and requirements that you need to study abroad. And now we have covered, like, obviously I'm in Netherlands, so I cover Netherlands, and also there are some of the alumni, some of our juniors and seniors who are in Germany, and I try to like contact them and have some interview sessions so that it can benefit you all. You can learn something from their experiences, and slowly we are expanding like to Switzerland and other countries in Europe. So what I am going to discuss now will be very brief. Obviously, I am very open and I am available to everyone after this session to have one-to-one discussion, and you can also write your questions digitally. I have arranged it for you. So that's why I said like this discussion will be like a drop in the ocean, not the whole thing that you are supposed to gain from it. So basically, I'll be covering this four things, and apart from that, I might because these are the broadly four things, because the reason for which people choose to go abroad. So either you go abroad after doing your master's for a PhD, or for MBA after a certain work experience, or maybe for master's or for job. So these are the basic requirements which most people know and some might not know. If you are in second year and you are very curious, so that's why I thought why not cover these things. And by the way, I forgot to ask one thing. Are there any master's students here? Okay. So you want to apply for PhD, right?
PhD.
Okay,
that's good.
So the basic requirements till 2018, GRE. I think even till today, GRE is optional for not for every European university, but for most universities. And a score above 310 can be a good score. It might be very tricky, but if you are above 320, then you are always safe, even if you apply for US or Europe or any place. So that's why I mentioned both the brackets. And for the TOEFL, I don't know much about IELTS because I didn't give IELTS, I gave only TOEFL. So for TOEFL, most universities ask for a score of greater than 90, or some PhD programs ask for greater than 100. Because you are supposed to write papers and give presentation in conferences and other things. And for IELTS, these are the scores, and I don't know much about IELTS. For MBA, you need GMAT. I only know about one university in Netherlands, that is Erasmus Rotterdam. If any of you are interested for MBA, it's a very good university. But I don't know much, but probably in 2-3 months in my channel I might share some interview sessions, because I contacted some people who finished the MBA and are working in Shell, and they might share their experiences, like how was the MBA and other kind of things. So presently in my channel you will find only about Masters, PhD and probably about Bachelors. So the motivation letter, recommendation letter, these are the common things which everyone knows. And this session, I cannot cover what is a good SOP, but this matters a lot when you are applying, even if for PhD or for a master's. We can talk about it later, but and there are by the way some videos in the channel where you can find all the details. I will just touch upon everything. So for the recommendation letters and a decent GPA. Decent GPA can be like, that is again very tricky. So if you are applying for Germany, ideally GPA greater than 8 is considered very good. I would say it's like a cutoff. So if you are below it, in most German universities, if you are applying for tier 1 universities, it might be very difficult to get an M. But if you are applying for a, suppose 40 in the Netherlands, then maybe the GPA of 6 or 6-7 can be a good GPA. So it matters a lot from university, but the film is not the film. And these are the publications, the main thing is not mandatory. Many people have misconception that you must have a publication before you apply for PhD from India, suppose you are applying from India. But it's again not mandatory to have a PhD, but obviously it gives an edge over the pool of applicants. And regarding experience, I think you all of you know more about it than me. So you can work, or you can like a junior research fellow. Many people go after GATE to do junior research fellow in some IITs for 6 months or 1 year. and that counts a lot when you're applying for German universities. It's not that much beneficial for Netherlands, but for Germany it's very, very useful when you apply for a master's or something to get scholarships. And regarding internship, that also most people know, and research assistants and JRF are two different things. I don't know much about it, but I've heard from other people that both of them help you a lot when you're applying for Germany. And this is the most important thing, which helps you even in your interview and even in when you're writing your motivation letter or the SOP. It's very difficult to sum it up now in this talk, but storytelling is the main ingredient of really making it to that level or not making it to that level. So, for example, I can give one example, like, suppose you have like a, I have heard from many people, like they're from electronics or electrical background and they want to apply for computer science masters, or like they want to switch their streams. So in that case, normally when you apply abroad, it is very flexible, but still it's difficult to write it as a coherent story in the motivation letter, like to connect what experience you have from your, suppose you're working in a company, from the company, and how it helped you to, how it will help you when you are applying for that position or the master's. So, we can talk about it later, because I don't think I can cover it now, it's a very huge topic. So, what factors you should consider when you are applying abroad? For example, taking example of Europe, which I'm discussing now, suppose you are applying for some Nordic countries like Norway or Sweden or maybe Finland. So for some people, weather may be a big detriment in that kind of situation. Whereas if you are applying for Netherlands or Germany, most of the parts have like a temperate climate and you don't have that much problem with the weather. So you need to take it account based on your personal preferences, like what kind of weather you like. And the language. Language thing, I always mention it repeatedly, because when you compare Germany to Netherlands, in Netherlands more than 99.9% people speak English. And I can give you an example myself, because I've stayed for more than 4.5 years in Netherlands. And I have never faced any language barrier or any kind of issues with the language. But in Germany, the moment you enter Germany, like I stay in the south of Netherlands, which I showed you initially in the map. So the German border is very close to the place where I live, and I normally go there every weekend. And the moment you enter Aachen, the nearest city, you always find that no one understands English. And it's really, really true. And you can ask any of your seniors that when they apply for jobs in Germany, then you need to have a German CV in 95% of the cases. 5% are exceptions. So in that sense, language can have a big, play a big role if you compare Netherlands to Germany, which you don't find in any jobs or anything in Netherlands. And the cost of studying, which again, I can give you an example of Germany and Netherlands. Germany, 99% of the universities have no tuition fees. And I will mention the link where you can find all these details at the end of the talk. So, in Netherlands, the tuition fees have now increased a lot. It's, I think for technical courses, it's around 18,000 euros if you are planning to do a master's. The tuition fees per year is 18,000 euros, around 18,000 euros. And maybe I can also mention of the PhD. So, many people who contact me by seeing the videos or Quora or everywhere, they have this misconception that in PhD you give a tuition fee and you are given a scholarship and all kind of things. But it's not like that. So most of the European PhDs are like a job. So when you do a PhD, you are not exactly a student, but you are working just like you work for a company. You get all the employee benefits, you get a monthly salary, you pay tax to the government, and at the same time, you are always funded for any conference you visit all over the world. Along with the visa and everything, n number of costs, and there's no restriction that you can go for one or two conferences in a year. If you do, if you publish, you can always go for four, five, six, any number of conferences. So all these things, there are a lot of perks of doing a PhD in any European countries. Germany and Netherlands, the law is almost the same, only difference is that duration. Like PhD in Netherlands is 4 years, and in Germany it's, some places it's four, some places it's three. In Switzerland it's around six. So these things vary, but in most of these places you are like a, you are doing a job and you get many types of benefits. Regarding the scholarships, so in Germany, because you don't have to pay tuition fees, so your cost of living for 2 years for your entire studies will be somewhere around 10 to 14 lakhs rupees for 2 years. But if you come to Netherlands, because of the high tuition fees and everything, it will be somewhere around 40 to 45 lakhs rupees for 2 years masters. But getting a scholarship in Netherlands is very difficult. It's not like US that you have the government who is funding 100 or 200 scholarship or research assistantships, because some RAs require you to grade and teach master students. And not every master's, master's is still okay. Sometimes they ask you to do something for bachelor's. Bachelor courses are not all in English, so at that time you don't get the opportunity to do the RA or TA when you are studying master's and you want to guide the bachelor students. So language is not an issue, but getting these opportunities might be a problem sometimes when you want some kind of funding. So regarding scholarships, they give full scholarships, but it's very limited in Netherlands. So for example, in our time and now also, it's like around 20 or 30 people get full scholarships for masters in all Dutch universities from a pool of 2,000 applicants. So suppose 2,000 people get admit as internationals, then out of them only 25 to 30 people will get full scholarships. And they are always, as per the pattern as we see, like most people from IITs, if at all anyone gets from India, and with a 9 CGPA, greater than or equal to 9 CGPA, which is also difficult in IITs. So, yeah, so the thing is you need to decide whether you can overcome the language barrier, whether that is a barrier for you, or money is the barrier for you. You need to decide what are your personal preferences before choosing a country or the weather or something like that. And regarding the salary, on an average, the Dutch and German salary are almost the same. You pay very high taxes, and on hand, you get on an average of, for example, in my case, PhD, we have like a in the first year, we get very less salary in PhD, which is somewhere around, on an average, it's around 2,000 euro on hand per month. Compared to other countries, obviously it's very good, but when you spend, then it's not that good. So the thing is that from second year onwards, the salary gets increased a lot, and then you get somewhere around 2,500 euro per month on hand. Compared to jobs, in Netherlands and Germany, the jobs will pay you somewhere around the starting jobs without any work experience for freshers. They give somewhere around 2,500 euro to 2,800 euro on hand from the first year onwards without any work experience, the junior most position. Regarding the cost of living, I have made a detailed video on that in my channel. So even if you spend a lot, you will spend somewhere around, I would say, like 1,000 or 1,200 euro as a single person. And then you can easily save like more than 50% of what you get. So it's always wise to see the cost to savings ratio when you are choosing any country, instead of seeing the salary or instead of seeing the cost of living. So in that sense, I think it's very good, unless you have a lot of loan to repay when you start your job or PhD, and if you have done your master's before or something like that. So, and apart from that, you always get, according to the, I don't know about Germany for the benefits part, but in Netherlands, you get like a 13th month allowance and a holiday allowance, which is very common for any employee who works in Netherlands,
and many other benefits, like for buying a bike, because they are very eco-friendly, so they have very nice bike tracks. If you all know that Amsterdam is the bike capital of the world, and they promote the driving of bikes, by bike I mean bicycle. So in that sense, they give you tax benefit if you buy bikes, and there are many other benefits, something like that, which makes your salary non-taxable when you start earning, you'll know all those things. Regarding the work-life balance, I would say this thing is again like very difficult to explain, but I can give you an example from my PhD work-life balance. So 99% of the people will say digitally there is no work-life balance when you're doing a PhD, but I disagree. And the thing is that you need to, they have like an agenda-based approach to everything they do. Even if they meet their friends, sometimes it might be very rigid, but that helps you to plan out all your time slots very well, when you have like an agenda or a calendar where you decide what time slot you'll give for what event or what activity for that day. That helps a lot, that contributes a lot for the work-life balance. And normally it's like 8 hours per week. You are supposed to work 8 hours per week according to the Dutch law. It's also same in Germany. So it's like 8 hours per day and 40 hours per week. And in PhD, in my case, we have like 3 days where we go to the university or maybe to Frankfurt or other project partners, and 2 days we can work from home. And this work from home varies from university to university. Even in companies, you get to work from home. If you have really urgent something, you can work for the whole week from home. That is also possible. So there's a lot of flexibility and a lot of ways you can manage your time. No one is going to see how you're managing. They will only see your progress, like the milestones you meet and how you meet them in what time period. And regarding this, this is a very important point. Society and people, I don't think Nanda sir is here. So he was asking about the society and people. So the thing is that everyone asks this, like whether there's racism or how are the people, whether they're friendly, direct, or do you find yourself sociable enough to talk to people, go to parties and other kind of things. So my personal experience in Netherlands is very good. I mean, regarding racism, I have never seen in my case any racism in Netherlands. But it's not true for Germany. So I think I've mentioned about this in one of the videos. There was a guy in RWTH Aachen, he's doing masters, and we are having a short interview, and he mentioned that sometimes when you go to some clubs or some events, not everywhere, but some specific places, you have some kind of racial discrimination. It's not violent, but they don't allow you to go inside to those kind of events. So you will find some hints in Germany, and I don't know about the other European countries, but as I have heard, it exists in some places, but it's not that much that you feel something out of it. So what is the stay back period? This is an important thing, because recently I was talking with someone, he wants to study in UK. So some of the subscribers who contacted me in YouTube, they studied in UK 2 years back and they didn't have a stay back period. So they came back after their studies to, even it is valid for people doing PhDs, because if you want to work in R&D in a company after PhD abroad, then you need to have a stay back period after you finish, even if it is a job. You cannot stay without a valid work visa. So that is where the stay back period will help you. In Netherlands, it's 1 year. In UK, 2 years back, it was zero. But recently, I heard that they have amended the rules. So this becomes a deciding factor, because you should have, in my opinion, when you choose a country, you should have at least 1 year of stay back period, because you are never sure that you'll immediately get a job after you finish your studies or PhD or whatever. So I will mention you n number of things, but there is no right way. Until you try out and see which way suits you the best, there is no right way. So I can give you some examples of some of these examples might be redundant, you might already know them, but some of the examples might be useful, I'm not sure. I'm already taking out so much of the time. So the first point, I think 99% of the people will know that when you are applying for masters, for getting scholarships, you send short emails to professors mentioning your interests or maybe your website or something like that, because they don't have time to read your emails and other kind of things. And if any of you have programming backgrounds, then you'll understand the second point. So regarding the Stack Overflow. So Stack Overflow recently, apart from the programming projects, you can also find jobs related to like booking.com or any kind of software jobs. And Kaggle is also like a data science platform where you can get a lot of, I think most of you know it already, like lot of lumps of data set. And then you can, so what people do is like they have a GitHub page, and in GitHub they can maintain this the works that they do, which doesn't give them grade or doesn't give them benefit in any way, but they enjoy it, they do it. And then when they apply for jobs or PhD or something, they mention it, that it is their hobby, or they have this extracurricular page or something like that, and that helps you a lot. Then brings out you among others. It helps a lot. I've seen that personally in different examples. And regarding the academic website, I started my academic website when I started my PhD. I know many people procrastinate, and it's very difficult to like really make it, even if you use WordPress or some shortcuts and don't build it from scratch. But still, it's really difficult to make an academic website and then maintain it properly. But if you are, I think it is useful for everyone, but if you are planning to do a PhD after your master's, then I would highly recommend you to have an academic website and have a research blog. Like maybe you publish in a journal. Sometimes when you publish in a journal, if you're doing a PhD, you'll understand me, like if you know about it. So if you are publishing in a journal, it takes somewhere around 1 to 2 years to publish one paper in a very good impact factor journal. So in that moment, if you think that you are diminishing what you are reading or doing, then you can always maintain a weekly research blog or something like that, which kind of motivates you and also keeps your research visible on the surface for everyone to see. And I have many examples in Twitter. I don't know how many of you use Twitter. I don't think many will be using. That's still few. So I actively started using Twitter when I was applying for PhDs, because you'll be surprised to hear that I found the PhD opening via Twitter. Thing is, Twitter is not like all social media profiles, websites. You have like, because of the word limit, you and recently they have updated the settings of the timeline also, it is like time based. So if in 1 hour you don't see tweets from some of your followers, then it will vanish immediately. So the thing is, in Twitter, if you type it now also, PhD vacancies, you will see many PhD vacancies, and depending on the keywords, just like LinkedIn, Twitter is very handy tool for getting PhDs, even in non-CS fields, because many people misunderstand that if I'm not from computer science, then why will people be using Twitter? But it helps you a lot to gain some information about research projects, vacancies, and some kind of things. So, yeah. So, asking for the reason of rejection even after rejection. This point came here because recently I was planning to launch a series about PhD rejections. That will be like a 2-month web series where I'll launch in YouTube. So the idea is that before I got my PhD admit, I got around 35 or 36 rejections from the PhDs application that I'm making. So I took like 6 or 7 months. So the thing is, you need to plan out your time period if you're doing a master's or if you are doing MBA abroad and you are applying for jobs. You should always actively start looking for it in the second year itself, because sometimes it's not that you are unfit for that position, it's because they you don't match to their criteria. So you have certain talent or certain profile and they need something, but it's very difficult to always find a fit. So when you maximize your chances, like even for PhD, if you're applying for 50 or 100 places, then you always maximize your chances of getting an admit. Instead, if you sit idle and like apply for 10 and see, okay, I'm rejected from 10 and I stop applying, then when you start again after 2 months gap, you again start from ground zero. So that's like a very simple thing I think most people know, but when you say that to everyone, then they realize. Random direct messages in LinkedIn. I don't know how many of you have tried that before. Has any of you messaged any LinkedIn, like any recruiters in LinkedIn directly, like I need opening or something like that? One.
Two.
So this thing is like, it's very difficult, I don't know how to explain it, but you should not think anything. Like most people think like, okay, he's like this technical head or something like that. How am I going to contact him? Should I have etiquette or should I write it this way? Or what would he feel? Will it have an impact in future applications or something like that? But the thing is, what has been seen now in LinkedIn and also in Twitter, if you contact these people just with brief message with like a link to your bio or something like that, they might not reply, but similar to rejection. So if you apply, like if you contact like 50 people, then there is a probability that one or two will get back to you. So these are some of the unconventional approaches which can help you a lot when you are applying for jobs, even in India or abroad. And I think this everyone knows. So LinkedIn is very powerful. If you don't have a LinkedIn profile, I would highly recommend you to open a LinkedIn profile, have some connections, build some connections, see your related research interests or relevant working people, and then you'll get to know all these points, like how you can search for alumni in different companies and contacting the recruiters, and also about Quora. So Quora has now become so huge that just like Google, it's even better than Google, whatever I've seen recently. If you search for these kind of questions about studying masters in Sweden, studying masters in Germany, Netherlands, and all those places, you'll find every answer, almost every answer, because people are really answering and they have a very good moderation policy. These are some of the videos which I have in the channel which explain all these things in details, which I touched upon now. So you can look at them later. And regarding PhDs, because today morning someone asked me, I don't know how many of you know him, his name is Madan Mohan Behra. He has, I think he was 2016 or 17, he was doing masters in Germany and recently got a PhD in France, and now he's staying in Dunkirk. I think you have watched the movie Dunkirk, then you'll know that place. So he's staying in Dunkirk and his PhD is based in two countries. That is where the fourth point comes from, multi-country PhD. So that is also possible. So thing is, when you see the world, then it is very flexible. Like you can combine different aspects to form different kind of programs. There is now no strong boundary that your PhD should be either industry-based, university-based, because most of the PhDs in Germany and Netherlands are like, the red one, the brown one, both university and industry based, because your contract gives you, your contract is in such a way that you work something for the university and you also use that for the industry, and then you have your thesis based on your publications. So university and industry, multi-country, home scholarship funded. So the home scholarship funded, I don't know how useful it will be, but recently I heard from one of the subscribers, I think he was from Maharashtra, and he got a funding from the Maharashtra government to do a PhD, and so he got a scholarship from the home country, that is India itself, from the Maharashtra government, and then he went to do a PhD in Netherlands in Institute of Water Education, I think. So that is also one possibility. So I forgot to mention that regarding the scholarships, one of our senior, he once got a scholarship from Tata. So there are many external agencies which can also fund you for masters, because obviously if you get a PhD position, you don't need to arrange the funding because it's like a job. But for masters, you can arrange external funding from India itself, but you need to Google it. So you can find some companies like Tata and some other companies, they give you somewhere around 8 to 10 lakh rupees on a one-time basis. And that will somewhat compensate your cost. So that is one possibility. You can also do part-time PhDs. Some people are not that much interested to do PhDs, and they like go for, after masters they are doing a job 50% of the time, and 50% of the time they are doing PhDs. That is also possible. Like, you can spend PhD for 6 or 7 years, take to complete your PhD, and have like as a part-time. So it's very, very flexible, and you can design your own program. It's very customizable based on your personal preferences. So I think I mentioned all of this before. What I like about studying abroad and all other aspects is the flexibility, which I've been mentioning many times. And it's performance-based rather than etiquette-based. It's a very strong point. So the thing is that I'm not criticizing the way we work here, but the thing is that they don't care if, as I gave you in the example, how many hours you stay in the office or spend in the office, or how many hours you are with your senior or your supervisor or your manager. But suppose you have a milestone, like you have to give this project within 2 months, then you can give it. Even suppose you are working, like you are ill or you are working from home 3 days a week, they don't care. So it's based on your performance and milestones rather than the etiquette that you need to follow here. And they have an agenda, which I mentioned, like the calendar system, and you get a lot of exposure and opportunities. And the thing is, like, when no one pushes you or limits your thinking or whatever you are, how you want to expand or how you want to apply for a position or something like that, if you are not limited, then your creativity is really comes to the surface. So that's what helps you when you get this exposure and opportunities. And one thing I also forgot to mention, that sometimes when you are doing PhD or job, you suddenly land in some collaborations with some international companies. Like, for example, in my case, my PhD was initially internally funded, and later it was part of a project of 3 countries, Belgium, Germany, and Netherlands. And then recently, because my work was very similar, so there is a university, NTU, in Singapore. So they have a cell called NIE, National Institute of Education, inside NTU. And they wrote a proposal based on my PhD research, because it was a very emerging field. And then we suddenly started collaborating for some, like, we are like a consultant. We don't get any money. I don't get paid my salary from them. But we offer them something, and in return, suppose that clicks, then maybe after 3-4 months, I can pay like a research visit to NTU Singapore for 2-3 months, and then have some of my work done. And so, apart from PhD in jobs also, these are things, like, many things will open up when you see around how people work and talk with your colleagues and all. So the thing is, like, just don't listen to what I'm saying. Talk to other people who are abroad. I'll mention their names after this, whom I know personally. And I have asked them also, so if you contact them, they will definitely help you. They are in different countries, the alumni. So these are the important websites. So for Germany, DAG is like the holy Bible for Germany. So I have mentioned only very few websites. They are not that much, but these are the important ones. So DAG is like the holy Bible. If you go to DAG, you'll find every details, like the language of instruction. For Germany, it's like the Holy Bible. You'll get everything, A to Z, every detail about cost of living, cost of study, everything. And academic transfer is like the Holy Bible for all research-based and PhD positions in Netherlands. Academic transfer. So, and euraccess.eu, it is important for getting all the research positions all over Europe. Not only Netherlands, but all over Europe. And LinkedIn, I mentioned again and again, I would highly recommend you to open a LinkedIn profile and see the world. So, yeah, so I don't think I should give you any advice, but these are some of the points which I always say, even in conferences. So there is no right or wrong way. There are different ways before you arrive at your suitable way, the way that fits you the best. The more you try, the more you learn. Be positive. Keep trying. Don't stop after rejections. They will enrich your experience and make you stronger. And at some point when you feel that you are in a very good position, then start giving back. Like maybe sharing information or helping two people so that it will just cause a domino effect. These are the alumni that I mentioned. So Lenin Mishra, he's living in Amsterdam, and he has done his master's from TU Delft in computer in 3ME, I think, robotics, civil, and it was part of three faculties, robotics, civil, and some other, I don't remember. So he can guide you for masters or jobs in Netherlands. Just go to LinkedIn and in my contacts, just search for these names, you'll find their contacts. Because if you Google, there might be multiple names. So Madan Mohan Behra, I have also made some videos with Lenin Mishra, you can see in YouTube. I also made some videos with Madan. He is doing the one I mentioned before, like his PhD is in France and Belgium. So his PhD, I think, is like 3 years, 1.5 years in France, 1.5 years in Belgium, and he did his master's in Germany. And this guy, he is one of the most senior one, Manish Tripathi. He was, I think, in production master's. He did his master's in Netherlands, and I think his PhD now is in US, I'm not sure. He's doing like, there is another possibility which I forgot to mention. You can also do MBA and PhD combined. There are some universities, if you Google, you can also do PhD. So you can combine many courses together. There's a lot of possibilities. Asis Mishra, I think he was 2017 or 16, I don't remember. He also finished his master's. Now he's working in Frankfurt, he's doing jobs. These people I know personally, and I guarantee you that they are going to help you if you contact them by LinkedIn or any place. And Shreyanjali, she was our batch and she did a job here, and then she moved to Germany. Now she's, after finishing master's, she's doing jobs. And these last three guys, they recently moved to Germany to do master's. So they can also help you a lot if you want to like contact them, or they're definitely going to help you. So this sums up my talk. I always say this line for last 3 years. The greatest danger for most of us is not that our aim is too high and we miss it, but that it is too low and we reach it. So try to keep your aim high and be positive. And we can have a discussion about the questions, but there are so many people, so you can enter the questions here. You just scan the QR code and you can enter your questions in the Google form. And I will make sure to answer each of you if you put your email there. So I will answer each of you. It will take like 1 or 2 weeks. But even if I don't answer you by face to face today, I can answer you later. Thank you. Any language, Odia, Hindi, Bengali, English, 4 languages.
Actually, I am very much interested in doing the higher studies. So, actually, I am applying for GATE also. I have applied for GATE also. But I wanted to do MS or MTech, whatever it is in approach. So, what is your suggestion? Actually, I came in late, so I couldn't do the part.
Okay, I will also share the slides. If you scan the QR code and enter your questions, I will have your email, I will send you the slides, and I can also share with them so that they will share with you. So regarding GATE, one thing I also did not mention in my talk, that in Germany, and not all universities, you have to check that. If you check my, I mentioned the link of that, the website where you find everything about Germany. So most German universities, they accept GATE scores. So even if you don't get GRE, GATE scores are accepted by German universities and also some universities in Singapore. 2 years back in Singapore, they used to accept like NTU and NUS, but now I am not sure, you have to check in Google. So GATE scores in that sense are useful for those places, even if you don't give other exams like GRE or something.
Thank you.
Sorry, you mean you...
He doesn't have good grades.
In bachelor's.
Yes.
Yeah. So, most of the places when you apply for PhD, they look at your master's grade and the thesis of the project that you do in master's, because in Europe we call it thesis, like we have like a mini PhD, just like you have a 4-year PhD, you have a thesis for 9 months. So not, most of the time they see those grades, your bachelor grades, like it does not mean that you have a 40% or 50%, but what I mean to say is bachelor grades are not the deciding factor when they consider a PhD, but a master's grade are very much important, and the project of the thesis that you do, that is the most important, then the grades. So in that sense, I think you can try to improve now, but in that sense, you should not be that much worried about. Even without good grades.
Even if I'm not that good in grades, then which foreign universities are recommended?
He is asking that with lower grade, any specific universities are there who will allow for lower grades?
I think it's difficult to answer this question because even for PhD positions, it is not dependent on the university, it is dependent on the professor, because it's like a job, so they open the positions whenever they want and they have that criteria. It might vary from different faculties in the same university also, so it's difficult to say, like, unless you see.
I have a little bit of idea, and then most probably you are employing for MS, I think. PhD, with little bit of idea, I have a good MS thesis, and if you satisfy their requirement, your grades will not be a deciding factor, number one. Number two, if you want to go with a very low grade to American University, there are hundreds of universities. Well, grade doesn't matter. The GRE score will be better, and how do you write your SOP will matter. MS will be very easy, not very difficult. The only thing is that you should be prepared to go outside. That's all. GRE score is sufficient. But PhD, definitely, Europe and America, it has to be tested on the basis of your thesis or your knowledge in a particular area. Their BTEC grade will not be that important.
Preparations as of now, what is the ideal time? How much time would it take to prepare well and then give the exam, and what is the best way to do it?
Ideally, I would say you should start preparing the beginning of your third year if you are planning to go immediately after you finish your final year, because when you apply for masters, then you apply 1 year before during the fall. So 1 year is already before, and you need 1 year more before, because you want to appear for GRE, TOEFL and all these things and prepare the applications. So ideally, I would say beginning of third year or in the middle of third year is the recommended time to start preparing. And if you have not, then you should start now. Like, because for GRE and TOEFL, if you have an English medium background, I would say 3 months, 2 months for GRE is more than sufficient. For TOEFL, I think 1 week is sufficient for preparing for TOEFL. IELTS, I have no idea. For GRE and TOEFL, I have some links in Google Drive where there are like 7 GB of materials of ebooks. I forgot to paste them here. I will send it to you via the DNP. You can have, it has every collection of all the possible materials that you need for GRE or TOEFL. Whatever I know, Erasmus Mundus is mostly given for people with minimum 1 year work experience, and that gives you to study in 2 universities, and your entire tuition fee is covered, like it's free, so it's like a full scholarship. So in our batch, there are many people who studied like suppose 1 year masters in KTH Sweden, 1 year in TOEFL, or suppose 1 year in Finland, 1 year in TOEFL, or 1 year in Germany. And so it's like a joint university program. You have half of the time here, half of the time there. And most of the time they ask for minimum 1 year work experience, but I'm not sure about that. You have to check. It was there. I'm not sure what is it now. I can Google it, but it's better you check it. I'm not sure about that work experience thing. You mean the permanent residence? There's a video on that. So now you need 5 years of stay, including your studies, to apply for, to be eligible to apply for PR. And apart from that, you have to give other exams like the integration exam, where you need to have basic level of Dutch reading, writing, and something like that that I mentioned in the video. So yeah, 5 years. For the exam, for the PR, it is necessary, and that is very basic level, whatever I have heard from other people, because they also don't speak fluent. And for working and living there and jobs and everything, you don't need at all. Like, you need zero Dutch for working or these kind of things. But if you want to settle there for 20 years, then obviously I would recommend you to learn the language.
While starting in the university, is it necessary that we'll learn the language Dutch? Is it necessary?
No. Masters entirely is 100% in English. Bachelor's some are master, but in PhD and Masters it's entirely in English, so you don't need Dutch.
PhD?
It's entirely in English, so you don't need Dutch.
What is this? So how it affects my probability of getting admitted?
So
more.
Sorry.
For MS.
Yeah. You mean SOP, right? So SOP, statement of purpose, or motivation letter, as they call it, because some places have different names. So it's like you compile, you like make a statement to the admission committee of the university, like why you are worthy of a candidate to be eligible to be selected for that particular university. It's bit different from the CV. So what you do exactly in the CV is like you list all your like supposed rewards or extracurricular everything. But in SOP, you, as I mentioned about the storytelling, so you like make it a coherent story of 1000 words or 1500 words. So it's essentially you elaborate all those points in the CV without repeating them, and you try to stitch them to make a coherent story. Like for example, you are doing mathematics and then you did computer science, and then how you connect both of them and why you choose to change your streams and something like that. So you essentially make a story like which is really appealing to the admissions committee.
Another question. Are there any exposure for material science engineering or metallurgy engineering in Netherlands or Germany?
In metallurgy, I don't know exactly in that field, but I think it's better you search in LinkedIn. Like, just type metallurgy in Netherlands or metallurgy alumni in Netherlands, and you'll find lot of. LinkedIn is like your dictionary for all these kind of things, because every field, it's difficult for me to always stay also. So I don't have that much idea about it.
You are from computer science background.
Yes.
Means I want to know the practically which are the best specialization in that QDELF actually.
In QDELF.
Yes.
Okay. So, do you have any interest or what's your field of interest?
My field of interest means I have two field of interest. One is DS, data science. Another is machine learning and AI.
Okay. So the thing is, like, when you are, suppose you are doing a master thesis, when you do a master's, you have to compulsorily do a master thesis, which is like a 9 month period where you like read some papers and then write a literature review, find the loopholes, and then conduct some small studies and then write your thesis. So in that sense, I would say, like, have you seen, you can just Google UDELF, there are like 8 or 10 research groups in computer science. Closer to your interest will be something like, there's something called II, which is interactive intelligence. They work on robots, and it's like a overlap of artificial intelligence. I don't think they have that much of data science, but they have a lot of AI and pattern recognition. Even in pattern recognition groups, you might also find some interest. There's something called WIS, Web Information Systems, where I did my thesis. they have very multidisciplinary fields. So giving you an example, like they are working for smart city in Amsterdam with the Amsterdam municipality. One of my supervisors was working with them. So they have many sub projects. So suppose one of the PhD under him will work on a sub project on surveillance detection using the street cameras, and then predict something like whether some person is doing something or some activity or something like that. And then the master thesis will be like a sub part of that PhD where you will be training a small model. And so the thing is, like, in the beginning of your first year of masters, normally in Netherlands people approach this, because in the beginning, like in my case, in the beginning I had interest to work in algorithms. But when I started my thesis, before that my interest changed a lot. So it's very difficult to pre-decide, but you can always shortlist like 5-6 or something, and then when you go and meet them and talk with, apart from the professors, when you talk with postdocs or PhDs and see how their projects go and which things motivate you or interest you, then you'll see, like, you'll find, after some discussion, that's why I said, like, apart from me, it is better to have discussion with other people also, then you will have more wider perspective of all this. So I would say, like, just shortlist few and don't think that I'll work on that faculty, and then try to see which is, because even if you choose one, I highly doubt that it will stay the same, like, based on my and others' experiences.
Yes, flexibility of US masters is same as Netherlands?
Yeah. So the only difference that I see, based on what I've heard from my friends, is that in US you have this OPT, like the, you have this industrial something. I mean, the thesis is not compulsory in US, but in Europe, I think 99 or 100% of the places, thesis is a compulsory thing. And so in that sense, it is different. So I don't know, maybe it might be a detrimental factor for people who want to work after masters. But sometimes people say that during thesis, you have the option to do an industrial thesis. So sometimes people also do industrial thesis, and that's a good factor. Like, that helps them to get a job afterwards. So it's difficult to categorize that. Like,
there are actually two types of masters. One is
industrial-based,
another is research.
That is in US. But in Netherlands, it is compulsory to do a thesis, even if you do with a university or do with a, they call it the thesis, and that is compulsory. You don't have any, you cannot go away with your masters only doing internship or something like that. That can be add-on, but thesis is compulsory, and that helps you a lot when you are planning to do a PhD afterwards. Then you get a lot of how to write and how to read and all these things. It helps you a lot, because even in the beginning, I remember my case, like first 4 months of my master thesis, I was not able to frame a research question, which was a very big deal for them, even if it is a very simple thing. But that exposure and that period, that struggle helped a lot when I was starting my PhD and writing the proposal for the 1 year review in the first year. So that's what I can say. So just like as I mentioned to him, so for Germany, some places, even if they accept like GATE scores, and even if you don't have GRE, they also accept GATE scores. All these things you can find in that. So there are some universities which only ask for GATE, which only ask for GRE, but GRE, most places they ask, most good universities like Munich and Stuttgart and I don't remember the name. Most of the universities, they ask for GRE in Germany. It's not true for Netherlands. And TOEFL is mandatory for everyone, like all, any PhD, any test of English, it's IELTS or TOEFL, whatever is. Okay, maybe I don't know that. I mean, whatever I know, it is mandatory, but you can always look in that. If it is not there, then it's not. Sorry? If you want to work after your master's or PhDs, then it's 100% required to learn the German language. So that's why people, the names that I mentioned here, they did A1 in India, whatever I've heard from them, and then they did the A2B1 in Germany. Sorry? No. You don't need for study. because most of the university's masters is in English, which you can always search in that, like whether it is 50 German, 50 English or 100 English, but most of them are in English, so that's not a problem. But for the society and the jobs and the CV, you need that. I'm staying in Netherlands, so I'm biased, but I think it's difficult to say whether US is good or Germany is good. But one thing on which I can discriminate is the time period. In US also people sometimes finish in 4 years, it depends on your supervisor and the program, but it may stretch to 6, which does not ideally in Netherlands, I mean, because it's a contract, so they don't pay you the salary. So I have heard max it goes to 4.5, it has never crossed that, or it's you stop your PhD, which is also very rare. So in that sense, because of the salary what you get, like because they are in US, you are a student, and you have to also fulfill certain courses, which is not the same in Netherlands. So in that sense, on that ground, like the salary and the benefits, and because you are not a student, I would say, and if you compare the research, I'm not sure. Maybe in some field it might be better, some field it might not be better. That's difficult to say, compare for me. Normally, as I mentioned, you should start looking for jobs or PhD in the second year, beginning of second year masters, which is very early. But if you want to get into that immediately, then I would recommend you to do that. That's what I also did. So it's better to always search early, otherwise you have to apply the stay back period, pay extra money, and it's a lot of headache. Like, any more questions?
I'm in 4th year now. Next year I'll be completing masters. I'm in 12 degree mathematics. Then what is your suggestion? I mean, do I really need a thesis to go abroad? I mean, in Europe.
I don't know. Suppose, I mean, for example, you give date and get rank 1 or rank 2 and get into IIT. Do you have any idea how is the master's in IIT? Like, do they have a thesis or what is the structure of the master's, or do they have a project or?
No, actually I don't have any idea now.
Because even if you don't have a thesis, as per the name they call it, but even if you have a project, that is also okay. And I think they will have something definitely. So just try to make it, give your effort into it, and maybe also publish something. Like, although it's not mandatory, but try to publish one paper out of your project or the thesis, and then you already improve your chances among the pool of applicants that are applying.
What were the initial struggles that you went through before, I mean, after entering a new country?
Okay, so there was a video on that. I don't remember. It was like a 30-minute video. You can check in YouTube. The title was Common Problems That People Face When They Arrive First Time for the Masters. So I can talk about 2 or 3 considering the time. Cost was obviously the first, because whenever we go, we convert it to rupees and then we see, okay, we won't take this and take half kilo and manage with this and live with less of this or that or like that. And that faded away slowly, although it was there, but after 2-3 months, we never converted to rupees. That is very, you should see it, but it's very difficult if you always convert and then your mental blockage will start. And apart from that, like adapting to the teaching style and everything was different, because personally what I feel here, it was more theory based and there it was very much practical based. And the more you open up to the practical, you'll have always the fear of failure, like you'll make some errors and then how am I going. But if you just, I mean, it's difficult to say, but if you just work on it and have 2-3 times failure and then you overcome it yourself without taking anyone's help, then you will gain the confidence. And that's like, the more you do, then only you will learn. Otherwise, it's that's what I have seen when working with group projects or during your master thesis also sometimes you might feel alone, depending on what type of thesis you are doing, whether you are working in a company. If you work in a company, you are always surrounded by a lot of people, you don't feel alone. Mine was with the university because I wanted a PhD afterwards. So in the beginning I felt kind of lonely, but then slowly, like, you talk to people. That's why I say always talk to many people, you'll get across many ideas, because my idea might be in some way beneficial, but 10 more people will give you better ideas than me. So talk to many people and develop a network.
Is there any master courses in Europe which are, if after taking the master course, that can be directly converted to PhD course?
I don't think so. Normally what happens is, like, if you are in a faculty, suppose, and you are doing masters, if you are really good and your thesis also have like one publication, or even if no publication but a supervisor is really happy with your work, then normally they offer the PhD. I mean, it's not like a master converted to PhD, but they have certain funding for certain positions, and immediately after your master's they will offer you, before you start looking, you can also have a discussion with them. You'll feel that he's really satisfied with you, and you'll, when you approach him, he'll say, okay, after this 3 months I have this position, I can offer you, are you interested or not? So that kind of thing happens, but it's never, there is no way that you can have like a direct PhD or a, like a 5 year where you have 1 year master's and 4 years. It's not there anymore. For masters, I would recommend go to individual websites for the universities. For PhD, just look for, if you have finished masters and you are applying for PhD in Europe, then just look for this website, because it's like a job, so you always get these positions every month, not like a fall, spring or something like you do in US, so it's very different. But for masters, I would recommend not to go to a consultancy and do it yourself, going to individual university websites, because they help you a lot in terms of planning and shortlisting and all these things. But when they're at the SOP, I have faced personally, because in the last 2 years, I think 5 or 6 people have contacted me personally and I've helped them with the SOP. And it's not that good when they write the SOP. So they ask you for a certain amount of keywords, and when you give them those keywords or your bio or something like that, they make the SOP, and I don't trust that. It might be people are getting admitted, but I would not recommend it. So I think we should call it a day. Netherlands is a new holiday, Netherlands. Germany is about important, so the master's apply also. But Netherlands, even with 6 CGPA, you can get admit in TU Delft, which is very good. But specific subjects, CGPA 7 dekhande. When I suppose you are applying from civil, then they will see not your applied mathematics, but your civil related stuff. So there are people, last year get a contact for LinkedIn, NIT 3G, or good year of 11. The NIT teacher would have CGPA 8.2, but still say reject your TU Delft, because the subject specific grades, jo faculty may apply for thila, sadar bahut kam thila, but the overall CGPA bhala thila. The TU Delft overall cut off India may have 6, but subject specific grades would have 7, 6.5, and say specific would have bhala thila, tum apne 6 thile ke admit hawar chance 99%. TU Delft, many most Dutch universities till now, acceptance rate is very high compared to US or good universities. Like US good universities, 20-30% high acceptance rate. Netherlands is 70% around. But tapore survive kari ato masters is very difficult, because it's very different. So first 2-3 months that you used to here, then you can easily pick on. Pick up. Sitter is the main crucial time factor. When I first initially. Sorry? Germany, Netherlands, education system almost same, with a difference nahi. Maine master's from Goji, difference nahi. Only kathai la Germany gale financial load rahi wani ke nahi mara tuition fee zero hai gala. Only mara ikhar chala wapa maa ye kore nahi, loan nahi, tension nahi. So, sita would a factor, but tapre depend kore chata. Maa aguru A1 sikhi ki jau chata, kena tamo prepare hi jau chata. Maa isolated feel kari yu, Germany ne kathai hai. So, see so answer ho chata.
Oh, yeah.